Hi, my name is Cindy Farr, and I'm the incident commander for the Missoula City County Health Department's COVID-19 response. Today is Monday, April 13th, and this is my daily briefing. We've had a total of 32 cases to date in Missoula. 30 of those cases were identified by testing, and 2 were what we call epi-linked. We've had 24 cases that have recovered, and that leaves 8 active cases at this time. We're monitoring 155 close contacts who are in quarantine, and over 1,270 tests have been performed in Missoula County. The state has had a total of 394 cases, and there have been 7 deaths in the state, with 1 in our county. So I just mentioned that we have 2 cases that are epidemiologically linked, or epi-linked, and I just want to take a moment to explain what that means. Up until this weekend, all of the cases in Missoula County were found through laboratory testing, and as you've heard from me before, when we find out that someone tests positive, our public health nurses make sure that they isolate and then they start a case investigation. They identify the person's close contacts and confidentially reach out to those people and ask them to quarantine. Then the nurses follow up with everyone twice a day until the 14-day incubation period has expired. And if a close contact develops symptoms in the 14-day incubation period, we try to connect them with a healthcare provider for confirmatory testing. Excuse me, sorry, I'm having a little bit of allergies today. However, since sampling resources are tight, we can use a case classification that is well established in epidemiology to consider the person a case without actually testing them. This practice is pretty regularly used in outbreaks from everything from pertussis to E. coli. So with COVID-19, we know the symptoms, the onset, and that it passes from person to person. And being a close contact to someone with a confirmed case of COVID-19 and then later developing symptoms within that incubation period can be enough to consider them epi-linked but unconfirmed case. So for those of you who might be worried that this might hinder our public health response or that it means that there's less follow-through, don't worry, it doesn't. The biggest hurdle is identifying the cases so that we can have that person isolate. That still happens with epi-linked cases, so as far as exposure or risk to the public, to public's health, there isn't an increased risk. What this does change is how things are actually reported out to you. So we want to be transparent and report all cases and not just the lab-confirmed cases. So what you'll notice now on our website is that there are going to be 2 categories of cases. Positive COVID-19, which are the number of people who are laboratory tested, and then epi-linked, which are the people with COVID-19 who are not lab-confirmed. If you just add those 2 numbers together, then you're going to get the total number of cases from Missoula County. But I do want to point out that our state health department website is only going to be listing the lab-confirmed cases. So our numbers are going to be just a little bit different than what you see on the DPHHS state health department website. So on Friday, the staff working to enforce the governor's directives closed fabric and hobby stores. We know that there were a lot of people who are upset about this, and they feel that this move didn't make sense in light of the CDC's recommendations for cloth face coverings. I just want to discuss how and why this happened, and again, provide clarification on CDC's guidance, including some really important points that I think people might be missing. I want to start off by saying that our department originally interpreted the governor's directives to include these businesses in the essential category. The health department staff worked with those stores to minimize the risk to customers and employees. However, another Montana county asked the state for a legal opinion on this. And that legal opinion came down at the end of last week. It stated that these businesses are not considered essential. It said, and I quote, "The directive is to slow the spread of COVID-19 to the greatest extent possible while ensuring that people self-isolate in their places of residence to the maximum extent feasible while enabling only essential services to continue." Characterizing craft and hobby stores as an essential business, as essential businesses on the basis that a de minimis amount of total material sold might be used by others to assemble masks would frustrate the purposes of the directive, end quote. Once we got this legal opinion, we had to change course and ask those stores to close. I think that while this legal opinion may frustrate people, it's really important to consider what it's saying. The governor's stay-at-home directive that required non-essential businesses to close had the objective of keeping people at home as much as possible to avoid unnecessary congregation and to support social distancing. Social distancing and staying at home are the best preventative tools that we have to slow the spread of COVID-19. The CDC's face covering recommendation was never meant to be in place of social distancing, and it's not deemed to be effective on its own. To dismiss social distancing to get supplies to make face coverings goes against that objective. As we've discussed before, cloth face coverings are not personal protective equipment or PPE for the person wearing the cloth face covering. They're meant as additional tools to prevent people who don't have symptoms from exposing others when social distancing is not possible. So let's talk once again about the face covering recommendations. The recommendation wasn't that everybody needs to sew masks. That was not it at all. The recommendation was that people should cover their mouth and nose with some sort of cloth. The recommendation is to use a cloth face covering, and it doesn't need to be sewn or made specifically for this purpose, nor does it need to have a certain shape to be effective. A bandana, a scarf, many of the other things that you might already have at home can definitely be used, and you don't need to go to the fabric store or learn how to sew to make this happen, especially if social distancing goes out the window. If you're passionate about doing this, you can definitely still order supplies online while adhering to social distancing, or use curbside pickup at Walmart, a store that is still open, which also has fabric. So I just wanted to make sure that we were just really clear on that you know, we did have to change our recommendations for those fabric stores based on the legal guidance that came down from the state health department. But that does not necessarily mean that you can't still make masks if you get fabric from another place. But it is really important to just remember that it doesn't have to be a mask that you use to cover your face. You can use anything that you happen to have on hand and available, and that is meant to protect other people from you in the instance that you might have this disease and just not be having symptoms yet. So that's all I have for my daily briefing. I will talk to you all again tomorrow. Thank you for everything that you are doing to keep our communities safe.